You will now be placed into conference. An anonymous participant has joined.
Okay, hello class. I'm Instructor Howard, and what I have here is some coding practice that is taken from evaluation and management, which seems to be a little bit more complicated to some of you than others, and also the medicine section. So what I do have here are some cases that I've already gone through and included the answers, and what I'll do is walk you through each of them. I've highlighted some very important portions of each case to let you all know how to review and read each of your cases and what's important when you are actually, you know, doing your coding for ICD-9 and CPT. So I'm going to go through each case and explain it to you and explain the answers, and you can use this presentation to help you with any type of coding. Just because it's E&M and medicine does not necessarily mean that this is all you would apply it to, because the cases are written the same for each section or body system that you're working in. So, you know, some of the most complicated ones do come out of, you know, evaluation and management as well as the medicine section, because you really don't know where to begin. You don't know or understand what it is that you're looking for. So I'm going to move on. Number one, I have, I'm going to read the case. And as you can see, I've already highlighted the words in the answer. But it just basically says Dr. Lewis treated an established patient in the office who complained of a 3-month history of fatigue and weight loss. It also tells us already that the comprehensive history and exam were performed. Medical decision making was of high complexity. So we have our key words here, established patient, and the place of service is the office. We also have comprehensive history and comprehensive exam and medical decision making of high complexity. It doesn't matter if you're using a 2012 or a 2011 CPT manual. I will be referring back and forth to the 2011 and the 2012 for CPT, but I do have my ICD-9 is 2011 in front of me, and I don't have room on my desk for all four books. So I'm trying to kind of trim it down a little bit. So if you have a different book than what I'm using and your answer is a little bit different or your page number is different, then you can basically email me and ask me, you know, you use this book or you said this on this page and my answer is different. You know, what do I do with a 2011 or a 2012 and vice versa? So if you look at your evaluation and management section, one of the important things that you need to know about E&M coding is that you do not have to go to the index first to find what you're looking for. The E&M section is organized by the place of service and the type of service that's rendered. So what we need to do is, and in front of me I have a 2012, so I'm going to go to, let's see, page 9. Page 9, I see at the bottom, 99215, it tells us right here that this code is for the evaluation and management of an established patient, which requires at least two of these three components, at least two. You don't have to have all three. You have to have at least two. Comprehensive history, comprehensive exam, MDM of high complexity. Now, how do I know to just go to page 8? Because it's an evaluation and management service, and it is office or other outpatient services, which is showing me on page 8 at the very top. Then I find my code. I go down the list to search for established patient. That's at the bottom of page 8. I go over to page 9, and I continue to match the key components until I find the correct code. Establish patient, comprehensive, and high complexity, 99215. Okay, so number two. Once again, another established patient was seen in her primary care physician office. However, the services were not rendered there. So I highlighted that just to let you know that sometimes you have to continue to read on. You can't just say established patient, office, seen in the office, and leave it at that. We go further down, and what I've highlighted in red tells us what we need to code. Due to possible concussion, the patient was sent to the hospital to be admitted as an observation patient. So from there, I go and I look in my CPT for observation services. They also are on page 9 of the 2012. I see where it says observation care discharge service, and then I flip over to, or I continue to read down, and I see initial observation care, new or established, is giving me some special notes explaining what they are, what the code ranges are, and how do I use them, and all of that information that's very important if you've never coded E&M or if you've never coded observation before. So I continue to read initial observation care. How do I know it's initial? Because the patient is being admitted. Anytime a patient is being admitted to the hospital, you're always going to code the first service as an initial service. So then I match up my key components. I see that in my highlighted area, there was a detailed history and examination were performed. I look on my page. Right now I'm on page 10. And it says 99218, initial observation care per day for the evaluation and management of a patient, which requires these three components: detailed or comprehensive history, detailed or comprehensive exam, medical decision making that is straightforward or low complexity. So I go back and I review what my description is telling me I need to code for. Detailed history, detailed examination, and medical decision-making of low complexity. Now, moving further, I have some more information. So I also know that I do and I can use this 99218 code, but the additional information tells me that the patient stayed overnight and was discharged the next afternoon. So since the code 99218 is just for the initial observation care or the admission, I need to find an additional code for my discharge. At this time, I'm going to flip back because I noticed that when I was on page 9, I have observation care discharge services right here. So it's telling me 99217 is observation care discharge day management. This code is to be utilized by the physician to report all services provided to the patient on discharge from observation status. Now, if I read my special notes, it's also telling me that there are some other codes that I could use for inpatient services, or if the person was admitted and discharged on the same day, there's another code. So I can continue to move on through the pages and look for that information just to make sure that I do have the correct code and, go through my CPT and make sure that I'm not overlooking anything. For instance, on page 12, let me see, observation or inpatient care services, including admission and discharge. It is telling me 99234 and 99235 are also my options. But because the patient was discharged the next day, I would use the 99218 and 99217 to report services for each day. But if the patient just went in and left the same day, 5 or 10 hours, then I know that I can use a 99234 or a 99235. Okay. So moving on. I have critical care services highlighted because every time you read an operative report or a chart note, It usually comes with a heading telling you what the services were for. So I automatically draw my attention to critical care service. I know that my services that I'm coding for will have to come from critical care. It won't be a regular E&M, it won't be surgery, and it won't be anything other than critical care. Okay, so this is a really long case. But what I'm going to do is just read to you what I've highlighted just so that you can know exactly how to go through here and search for the needed facts and move on. You shouldn't have to spend any more than 5, maybe 7 minutes on a long case, and that's because you have multiple diagnoses. What I mean is you may take your time to go through the coding manual and code it, but you shouldn't take a long time reviewing the case itself, and I'm going to show you why. Okay, we have our location highlighted, hospital emergency department. We also have that we're billing for the physician, so we're not billing for the facility. We're billing for the doctor inside of the hospital emergency department. So here, the very first sentence of the paragraph or the case draws my attention. Patient is a 23-year-old Hispanic female who took some medications to sleep tonight, including what sounds like amitriptyline and hydrocodone. Okay, so we move further down, and I already see when I go through, you know, just kind of skimming through the case, that the patient ended up in the emergency room. The patient has some issues with her QRS waves, with her, that's cardiologic. And then the patient has some problems with her blood pressure dropping. But then I move down and I see that we resuscitated her for more than 20 minutes. So I know that there are some critical care services that were rendered just because she's been resuscitated. So let me see, where's my next page? Okay, so moving further is showing us what her arterial blood gases were, what all of her lab results were, a lot of all of this other information that may not be important to what you're coding. So it's telling us also at the very bottom, very first sentence, the middle, and the last. After 20 minutes, the patient was having no cardiac activity whatsoever. After 20 minutes, decided to stop CPR after discussing this with her husband. Moving down, I see discharge diagnosis, cardiac arrest, tricyclic antidepressant, resulting in severe neural and cardiac toxicity and eventually resulting in death. Time spent with the patient was 120 minutes. So right here, we know that the patient has passed away. We know that they did critical care services with all of these other things that are included. You're not going to code for them individually. For critical care services, everything is all-inclusive. It doesn't matter what you do. The only thing that matters is the time. Doesn't matter how much oxygen they gave her, how much medication they gave her, how many tubes they used on her at that time. The only thing that mattered is the critical care services, because these services are billed per time. So I'm going to go find critical care in my E&M section. In the 2012, I am on page 17. I have to move my ICD-9 out of the way because I'm also going to open my 2011 and see what page that I'm on in there. Critical care in the 2011 starts on page 15. Now, some of you may still be using 2011. Some of you may just be using the 2012. Some of you may have the 2012 textbook, but you're using a 2011 CPT manual. But one thing you're going to know is with E&M services and the medicine section, almost every year, many of these codes stay the same. So it really doesn't matter. But I wanted to give you guys the page number so that you can look at the charts. So when you get to page 15 in the 2011, it begins there, and then on page 16, there's a very long special note section for critical care services. It explains to you everything that is included in the services for the patient. All of the lab work, all of the other tests, any of the additional services that you see that's written inside of the chart note that they did is all included. You don't even have to worry about, should I code for this, this, and this? What should I be looking for? You just know that, you know, you're going to code or bill by time. So in the 2012, you turn to page 18, you see a chart. 2011, you turn to page 17, you see a chart. Okay, it says here, basically we see that the services have to be performed more than 30 minutes, and they were. So for the first 30 to 74 minutes, we would code 99291. Initially, we would only code that one time, and that's what I have here as my answer. Now, for services that are greater than 75 to 104 minutes is 99291 times 1 and 99292 times 1 again. Anything over 105 to 134 minutes, we would code basically the 99292 an additional time. So you're always going to have a 99291. You cannot code the 99292 alone. You need to code both services. When you look under your chart, you're going to see a plus symbol next to 99292 that tells you that you have to use the standalone code, which is the 99291, with this code. The 99292 can never be used alone. So we see that the services basically have been billed in full for each procedure, 99291, 99292 times 2. And that's it. So now we talk about the discharge diagnosis. Anytime you need to know what your diagnosis are and what you're coding for, you do not have to worry about going back through the chart note and reading everything and highlighting it. The only time you would do that is if you're not sure the type of problem that the person has or if the person is on medication with this. And that happens usually when you're doing your diagnosis coding and you see something that says, insulin dependent or non-insulin dependent. So sometimes you want to go back through your chart note to see if the doctor mentioned it in there. Oftentimes he's going to put that in his discharge diagnosis or his assessment, which is another portion of the chart note that will help you with your coding. Okay, so our discharge diagnoses are highlighted. We have cardiac arrest. We have tricyclic antidepressant, resulting in severe neural and cardiac toxicity and eventually resulting in death. So for my first ICD-9 code, I have 427.5. That code represents cardiac arrest. How do I get that code? I got it by going to my ICD-9 manual and going to the word arrest or arrested and then go and look for cardiac. And then you're going to see your options. And, of course, you're always going to follow up in Volume 1 to look for the proper fourth or fifth digit if it's not included. You're always going to code from Volume 1. Volume 2 is just for you to look it up alphabetically, and you cross-reference everything with Volume 1. So my next diagnosis I have here is explaining her poisoning, but I also, it's not poisoning, but it's just basically accidental overdose or accidental poisoning because she took her medications as normal. So we have 965.09, which explains that the poisoning portion, and then we have 969.05 and E85.40. So if you go to Table and Drugs and Chemicals in your ICD-9 manual, you can go down to the word amitriptyline, and you're going to see both codes on the table. You're going to use both codes because it explains everything that happened. Since she took an additional medication, you have to go back to the hydrocodone, which is also on the table of drugs and chemicals, and you will code the 965.09, and which is the first column, and the E850.2, which is accident. And that will explain everything that happened to the patient. So since we're billing just for the physician and emergency department, we do not have to charge anything additional for the facility services. So we just have the 99291, 99292 times 2, and these diagnoses that are listed here. And even though this is a really long chart note, it's quite simple. Quite simple to code. Okay, moving on to the next case. Now, if I'm going too fast and you want to just look for your codes for each case, you can definitely do that. You can pause this and see if you can find your codes, on your own. And I know that it's hard to follow, the coding with me talking, so sometimes you can just go ahead and pause the presentation, and then once you get through or get your understanding, then move on to the next one. Okay, so here we have a discharge summary. That's our clue right there. Discharge summary. Location, inpatient hospital. We're billing for the attending physician, George Orbitz, MD. All right, so we do have a lot of information here. The examination, we have how the patient was admitted. However, we're not coding for the admission. We're only coding for the discharge because this is a discharge summary. We have the patient's discharge instructions, and it's telling us activity level as tolerated, the diet, which is renal diabetic diet. Discharge summaries usually include the list of medications that the patient takes, but we have nothing to do with that. And as you can see, I have highlighted the final diagnosis. So the final diagnosis, we have several diagnoses. We have the patient having end-stage renal disease on maintenance hemodialysis. We have hypertension, we have type 2 diabetes mellitus, questionable previous chronic use of non-steroidal anti-inflammatory drugs and inhibitors. We have anemia due to chronic renal failure. We have hyperkalemia. We have diverticulosis. That is post multiple herniorrhaphies. That is post cholecystectomy. And we see procedures performed. However, this is just to throw us off. That's why I highlighted this in red, so that you can see that we don't have to code for the procedures performed. The only thing that we're coding for is the discharge. So we move down. We see that the provider says, I spent a total of 50 minutes evaluating and reviewing the patient's medical record, and I spent an additional 20 minutes discussing the discharge plans with the patient. So the patient is in the inpatient hospital. So the only thing we need to do in the E&M section is go to inpatient hospital services. So if you have a 2011 book, you just flip over to inpatient hospital, discharge services, or inpatient hospital. And as you can see, I've already put the code in. Okay, so on page 12, we have hospital discharge services, which are also inside of the subsection for inpatient hospital. And then if you have a 2012, you do the same exact thing. Okay, so hospital discharge services are located on page 13 in 2012. The reason why I chose the 99239 is because it's more than 30 minutes. The provider tells you he spent 50 minutes discharging the patient. That's all we have to code for. We do not need the code for the hemodialysis services. However, we do need to code for all of these diagnoses. We have the 403.91, which is explaining the hypertension and or hypertensive with stage 5 end-stage renal disease classifiable with 585. How do we find this code? We know in the ICD-9 manual, you have a table for hypertension, the hypertension table. You go to your H's and you look up hypertension. How do I know to choose that particular hypertension? Because it's already telling us that the patient has end-stage renal disease. So when we code for hypertension, we're coding for the hypertension that's associated with her other complications or comorbidities. The complications and comorbidities is renal failure because she's at the end stage. So I have a 2011 ICD-9 book here with me. I'm going to go to my H's to find the hypertension table. And I have hypertension is the very first thing that you see at the top. Then, as you can see, with, and you see chronic kidney disease. But we also see stage 1 through 4, stage 5, or end stage, which is 403. And then we have whether it's malignant or benign, which are our two options. But since it's unspecified whether it's malignant or benign, we're just going to use 403.91. Okay, so the next thing that I have coded here is the 585.6. This is because the person has end-stage renal disease. How do I get to this code? I just go to disease because that's my main term, or disease, and then I go to the word renal, and then the type is end stage. Now, there's another way that you can find it. There's other ways that you can find these codes, but I'm just telling you the way that I chose them. And so that particular code is 585.6. Of course, you're always going to go back to volume 1 and verify your code. Okay, so I have a 2011 and disease shows up on page, well, it's a lot of pages for disease, so I'm just going to find disease and I'm going to find renal, which is also another word for kidney. And I'm on page 230, and I go to my R's alphabetically, and I see that renal has a lot of indentions up under it, which has, you know, with edema, acute, chronic, complicating, and this is where you can make a lot of errors because you may overlook something that's indented, or you may choose something that's indented before you get all the way down to your correct code. So what I do is I evaluate everything until I see exactly what my description that I'm looking for says or closest to it. So down in towards the end or the middle of the page, I see end stage 585.6. And, of course, you cross-reference that code. Okay, so you're always going to go to the back and double-check it. I'm just going to move on. My next code is 250.40, and I have a typo right here. It should be 250.40. Good thing I wrote them out before I typed them out. And I have that as being diabetes or diabetic with neuropathy. The reason I have diabetes or diabetic with neuropathy is because the code is an add-on code to another or end-stage renal disease. I'm sorry, not nephropathy. I don't know why I keep saying neuropathy. Nephropathy. Nephropathy, of course, is a disease of the kidneys. So when you cross-reference your code in the back, you're going to see your brackets. And you also are going to see additional codes next to it. So because the person does not just have regular type 2 diabetes, they do have diabetes with manifestations, and the manifestation is nephropathy. So let me go to 250.40. And the reason I'm not just using diabetes type 2 non-insulin dependent or insulin dependent is because I have additional information. You know that you're always going to code to the highest level of specificity. I have information that's telling me that the person has end-stage renal disease. So instead of me just coding diabetes, of course, I'm going to code, you know, something that matches everything that's going on with the patient and not leaving anything out. Now, in her chart, she may just have a code for diabetes, but since the disease is progressive, we get all of these additional codes added on to it. So I'm just going to look this up. And one of the reasons why I like to have my answers already filled in, because it takes a while to look up all of these codes. As you can see, I don't know if you can tell what time it is here, but it's pretty late. Okay, so 250.4 is diabetes with renal manifestation. And I have 0 through 3, which would be my fifth digit. I need to locate my chart, which is on page 803, which would give me my fifth digit, which is 0, because it's type 2 or unspecified type, not stated as uncontrolled. So since it's not stated and it's not type 1 and it's not giving me any additional information, I can use 250.40. However, when I go to the code 250.4, I do see that I have a big bold dot telling me I need to use an additional digit. So I have to pull my fifth digit from the page before it, which is on my little table explaining this. These 0, 1, 2, and 3 are to be used for the category 250. I can't just code without the fifth digit because that code would be inaccurate. And I also have a little note here that tells me to use additional code to identify manifestations as chronic kidney disease, nephropathy, NOS, or nephrosis. Now I have nephropathy because it's disease of the kidney. So my additional code would be 583.81. So that's how you pull your code that's in the bracket. And if you saw this in volume 2, you probably would have seen that additional code in the bracket as well. So the last thing I have here is hyperkalemia. I'm sorry, I have two additional codes. I have anemia, 285.21, and the last one would be hyperkalemia. And so those are pretty simple to find. What I did not code for is the diverticulosis status post due to humeral raphes, and that's because I removed my question mark. There was a question mark that says questionable diverticulosis. Anytime that you have something that's questionable on an outpatient basis, for an outpatient physician, we do not have to code the questionable diagnosis. We only code for the established diagnosis. on an inpatient basis, if he's treating him or her for these services, then of course you can code all of the things that are questionable, but not on an outpatient basis. So here are my codes here. My ICD-9, and as you can see, I coded for each of these. Okay, and I also have my CPT for the discharge. Okay, so number three, moving on, we have emergency and outpatient record. Location of the service was outpatient clinic, and we're coding for a physician or an independent physician. So I do have a lot of notes here that's telling me that this is a 17-year-old male who comes in after he got punched in the right side of his face. Mother is concerned because he is diabetic and has a couple of lip lacerations, also complained of some transient blurry vision, which has since improved. So we just see that the person has some lacerations where on the face, and he also had some blurred vision. So he basically has two problems that he's coming into the clinic for. Okay, so moving to the next page, we have physical examination here. We have the assessment, which shows all of his diagnosis, upper inner lip laceration, and lower lip abrasion, and right cheek contusion. Basically, it's two diagnoses because it's the lip same problem. It's just the doctor is just explaining it in detail. Okay, so as you can see here, the service is, let me see where we are. Okay, emergency department. I just wanted to make sure that that was right. Okay, I have my codes listed here, but I also have this case worked out because we do not see the medical decision-making spelled out. We do not see the history and exam spelled out. So this is where I'm using my audit form that I downloaded off the web, just a regular E&M audit form. The ones in the book, if you're using the step-by-step next step textbook, depending on what class you're in, you'll have some in your book that you could write on. But this is a good form that you can actually download and use. And if you're in BC 3020, I've already emailed this out to everyone. Okay, so I'm going to break down the examination, starting with the HPI, history of present illness, and what's explained and the rationale. We see that the provider is dealing with four elements: the location, which is the lip and the face, the severity, which talks about, whether the vision improved or, is it getting better, how severe the problem is. We have the context, which is what happened, that he was hit in the face. And we also have associated signs and symptoms that just talks about blurry vision and that he has diabetes. So those are additional things that we put here for history of present illness. The problem, the location, the severity, what happened, and things like that. Anything that is focusing on the problem. All right, your history. The review of systems. We're still in history, but now we're moving on to review of systems. We are dealing with the eyes and also the endocrine system. How did the endocrine system become involved? Because the person has diabetes. So that's dealing with your endocrine system. And we also have the history, which is dealing with, review of system, which is dealing with the eyes when you read the examination. So moving on or talking about that, we see that um, there were no past medical history. Let me go back to the chart. Let's see. He just did a physical examination, which is the pupils in the head, extraocular movement, tympanic membrane, the nose, basically the head and the face. But let me go back. Okay. He did not take any past medical information. So all of this is blank. He didn't take any family history. All of this is blank. He didn't take any social history. All of this is blank. Okay. So what I have here at the bottom is that he did the history of present illness, which equals 4, and the review of 2 systems, which is the eyes and the endocrine system. So we have expanded problem-focused history. And why we're dealing with expanded problem-focused history is because we have review of systems, which are 2, and the history of present illness equals 4. Over here just kind of breaks it down to you, and I'm not sure if you can see it because I can't see it very well. But the problem focus, which is brief, we have expanded problem focus, which is dealing with brief history of present illness and the review of systems alone, so just here and here. But he's not dealing with this over here, so it's not detailed. So that's why we're going to just deal with expanded. If he was just dealing with history of present illness or just the review of systems, then we would say that this is a brief history, but he did an expanded problem-focused history here and here, okay? So that's where we are with that. So let's move down to the examination, the type of examination that the provider renders. So he didn't do any constitutional elements. He basically dealt with two body areas, which is the head and the neck. He's talking about the normal cephalic, which is a normal head, and the neck is soft and supple. Okay, he dealt with 5 organ systems. Okay, he dealt with the eyes, like the pupils and the lenses. He dealt with the ophthalmic. He did some information about the inner ear, the otal exam. He dealt with the neck. He dealt with the head, which I have listed here. He also dealt with the skin because the problem is located on the skin. He did the palpations, and he also did the impact for the soft tissues, and you can go back and read that in the exam. So I just checked off everything here that was mentioned in his examination. Okay, so I have also the musculoskeletal system, which I put here for head for the TMJ, which is the temporal mandibular joint or tympanic membrane, which is also the muscular. Because you know the tympanic deals with the musculoskeletal system. I'm getting tongue-tied or tongue-twisted. So basically, I have 7 body areas. So here's my little chart, and I highlighted the 1997 because that's how I'm going to code my E&M based on the 1997 standards. We have problem focus, which is 1 through 5 elements. We have expanded problem focus, which is 6 through 11. So I have 7, so this gives me an expanded problem-focused examination. All right, let me go to the next page. Okay, so the number of diagnoses that the provider is dealing with is basically 2. He has number of diagnoses, which is 2 because he's talking about the laceration of the lip or the contusion of the lip, which is one and the same, and also, let's see, the table of risk. I put a 1 here for minimal because there's no risk. the person just was sent home, told to follow up. And then amount or complexity of data to review. I have no points in this area because there's no chart notes, there's no lab results, there's nothing else for the provider to review. So up here, I have a number one because it's self-limited or minor, stable, improved, or worsening. The maximum would be 2 points in this category. Or you see established problem to the examining physician. So since this is a new, I just put 1 point here and 1 point here. So number of diagnosis, 2, which is a low complexity. I have nothing here for the amount or complexity of data to be reviewed because there is none. And the risk of complications, further disease or death or mortality is minimal. So therefore, 2 of 3 of these components have to be 2 of 3 of these components. So I checked off low medical decision making here because this is minimal, and the diagnoses are 2. So let's sum it up. I have expanded problem focus history, a problem-focused exam, and a medical decision-making of low complexity because he didn't have to do anything further for the patient. So I ended this with an emergency room ENM of 99282. So if I go to my CPT manual, I will match these components up. Go here. I will match these components up according to how I completed my form. Hospital emergency room services. Let me go to, and I'm in the 2012 right now, and I'm on page 16. So here I have 99282, says expanded problem focus history, expanded problem-focused examination, and medical decision-making of low complexity. Only 2 out of the 3 of the key components have to be matched up in order for you to choose one of these examinations. So I use 99282. And, of course, let me go to the next page. You have your diagnosis of 873.43, which talks about the person having the wound of the lip, and it's an open wound because the provider needed to give him some stitches. And I have 920, which is a contusion on the cheek because the person got hit. Now, I also have an E917.9 because it was an injury from an external cause, so this is hit or hitting other persons. And that's, you know, it's not required, but I put it here and highlighted it in blue so that you all can see that that would be an additional code for you. All right, number 4, I have here as my hemodialysis progress note. So it's telling me up front what I'm coding for. Hemodialysis and where, outpatient hospital, and who, attending physician, George Orbitz. All right, so I have a lot of this information listed here, laboratory studies, physical exam, hemodialysis progress note. It's telling me that the patient is seen, and I can highlight this if I need to. Patient is seen and examined during hemodialysis. The patient appears to be hemodynamically stable, not in any form of respiratory distress or compromise. Now, how I coded this is dealing with my diagnosis, my assessment, and my plan. The assessment is always what the provider has diagnosed for today's visit. Your plan, as you can see in parentheses next to each diagnosis, is how he's going to treat this current problem. We have end-stage renal disease. We have hypertension, type 2 diabetes mellitus, and previous chronic use of NSAID and anemia due to chronic renal disease, and as you can see, questionable diverticulosis. This questionable situation is something I will not be coding for outpatient basis. As you can see, all of this information that I have here, I only have one code, 90935. Basically, because when I first started reading my chart note, hemodialysis progress note, outpatient hospital, patient is seen and examined during hemodialysis. In my CPT in the medicine section, the only thing I needed to go to was hemodialysis. Now, if I don't know how to search for hemodialysis for the examination, I just go to my index in the CPT manual, the word hemodialysis, and then I go back and cross-reference my code. I have hemodialysis 90935 through 90937. The code I chose was 90935. Let's go to the medicine section. And I know it seems like it's an E&M code because it starts with a 9, but it starts with a 90. So that's in the medicine section. Medicine section goes through 90s all the way through to some 99 codes. The rest of the 99 codes will be seen in the E&M section. And one thing about coding is that you have to learn your code sections by their numbers. When you see a code, you should know that this code comes from lab, radiology, surgery, just because of the code ranges that they're in. So I'm in the 2012, and I am currently on page, pass it up, page 325. I see hemodialysis. I go down. I see the code 90935 explains hemodialysis procedure with single physician examination. You read your chart note, I'm sorry, you read your special notes, and it tells us that this code is used for inpatient or outpatient evaluation and management during hemodialysis. So this is an appropriate code, and this is the only thing I need to code for besides my diagnosis. Once again, we have the hypertension with end-stage renal disease. We have diabetes mellitus with renal with neurologic with manifestations, and the type of manifestations is renal disease or renal failure. We have the 583.81, which is also for the renal disease or kidney disease or nephropathy, and then we also have 285.21, which is for the anemia due to chronic renal disease. All right, so moving on, and this is a similar case to the other patient, except for this one is coding for something different for the procedure. All right, so this is number 5. Clinic progress note, okay? So we also know that we're in an outpatient clinic. That is our location. Who we're coding for, a physician, his own practice, telling us right here, the patient presents to the physician's office for an examination after a C-section the previous week. This is very simple because it's, I highlighted here, she underwent a C-section last week along with a tubal ligation. So both of these previous situations here was surgery. When? Last week. Where is she now? Outpatient clinic. So basically she is coming in for a post-operative visit and staple removal. Staple removal and anything that is during the post-operative period is globally included in the procedure of the surgery or the initial surgery that was performed. Therefore, there's nothing else that we would code for except 99024, which is the outpatient, or I'm sorry, yes, the outpatient procedure code for the post-operative visit. Now, if you don't know how to find this code, because it's not located in the E&M section, even though it's a 99 code, 990, it is in the medicine section. How do we find this code? We just basically know it, learn it by heart, because it's been the same code for years, or we just go to our index in the back of the CPT manual and look up post-op or post-op visit, or you can just go through the medicine section and flip through, because you know that it's a medicine CPT code, and find it. But a lot of times, once you know or once you learn this code, you're going to always remember it because it's the only code that you can use for a post-op and has been like this for years. Okay, so her ICD-9 diagnosis codes are very simple because what happened, the patient gave birth. She's a mom, a new mom. So the main code that we would be coding for, would be a delivery, and the type is cesarean, and right now it's postpartum. So if we go to the ICD-9 manual, we can go down to delivery, or we can go to the word cesarean, or we can also go to postpartum condition or condition postpartum. It depends on the year of the book that you have, how you look it up. More than likely, you're going to be going to delivery. Now, since she's having sutures removed, you can go to the word attention, and underneath and then it would be sutures, okay? Or, and of course, they're not sutures, they're staples, but they're also known as sutures or suture removal in the ICD-9 book. Staples are also, you know, stitches as well. And then she has aftercare because she's given birth following surgery, NEC. It doesn't matter the type of surgery or the type of aftercare she has. It's just aftercare following surgery. And that's why I chose these three codes, because they explain everything in detail. Okay, so that's it, I think. That's the last case. Let's see. Yep, this is. That's the last case. So something about these things that I coded or these cases that I have coded does not make sense, or you can't find the code in your version of your book, then email me and ask me specifically how you would get it. What I'm going to do is set up this assessment or this particular quiz here as downloadable. So in one of the options, after you view the presentation, you should be able to download the pages, and you can walk yourself through it on your spare time. And I will make as many of these as I can as time permits, but as you can see, it took about an hour just to go through these five questions and explain it to you guys. I hope this helps. If you have any further questions, don't hesitate to give me a call. Have a great week. Thanks for watching.